Good morning, dear students. Hope all of you are fine. Today is our second social class. Do you remember anything that we studied in the last class? We can just recollect all the points of the previous class. We first studied about medieval India, isn't it? What is medieval India? It is the period between 8th and 18th century is known as medieval India. What is medieval India? The period between 8th and the 18th century is known as medieval India. And we also studied about Delhi, its topography, etc. We studied Delhi's location. That is, Delhi is located between Indo-Gangetic Plain, Aravalli Mountain Ranges and Yamuna River. Then we also studied some geographical features attracted some rulers to Delhi. Can you recollect all the points? Okay. So, today's topic is Delhi as a seat of power or Delhi as a center of power. Delhi first became a seat of power or center of power in 8th century under the leadership of Tomar kings who were the Rajputs. Do you know who were the Rajputs? The Rajputs were the Kshatriyas of the central and the northwest India. Tomars and the Chauhans were prominent among them. Once again, the Rajputs were the Kshatriyas of the central and northwest India. The Tomars and Chauhans were the prominent among them. Now we studied that Delhi first became a seat of power in 8th century under the leadership of Tomar kings who were Rajputs. In that time, Delhi was known as Dillika. After the Tomar kings, the Delhi was ruled by Chauhan dynasty. In this dynasty, or the Chauhan dynasty, Prithviraj Chauhan was the last king. After Prithviraj Chauhan, the Muhammad of Gore means in the present Afghanistan. After Prithviraj Chauhan, the Muhammad of Gore defeated Prithviraj Chauhan and established his dominance over Delhi. After Muhammad of Gore, Qutbuddin Aibak established his rule in Delhi. Qutbuddin Aibak was the commander-in-chief of Muhammad of Gore. Then Qutbuddin Aibak established his rule in Delhi as a seat of power. This dynasty is known as Mamluk dynasty or slave dynasty. Then next point is, four major dynasties ruled Delhi after the decline of the Mamluk dynasty. The rulers of Delhi after the Mamluk dynasty or slave dynasty were known as sultans. And the period is known as Sultanate period. I repeat, the rulers of Delhi between 1206 and 1526 are known as sultans, and the period of their regime is known as the Sultanate period. Dear students, I will show a flowchart. It will help you understand the chronological list, the dynasties and the respective major rulers during the Sultanate period. Then we move to the major rulers of Sultanate period. We know that the first dynasty in Delhi Sultanate was Mamluk dynasty or slave dynasty. After the slave dynasty, Delhi was ruled by the Khalji dynasty. After the Khalji dynasty, Delhi was ruled by the Tughlaq dynasty, then Said dynasty and Lodhi dynasty. The major rulers of the Mamluk dynasty was Qutbuddin Aibak, Iltutmish and Balban. After the Mamluk dynasty or the slave dynasty, the Delhi was ruled by the Khalji dynasty. Alauddin Khalji was the major ruler in the Khalji dynasty. Can you see this picture? Who is this? Alauddin Khalji. After the Khalji dynasty, the Delhi was ruled by the Tughlaq dynasty. The major rulers of this dynasty was Muhammad bin Tughlaq and Firoz Shah Tughlaq. The major rulers of the Tughlaq dynasty was Muhammad bin Tughlaq and Firoz Shah Tughlaq. After the Tughlaq dynasty, the Delhi was ruled by the Sayyid dynasty, and Kisirlan was the major ruler in this Sayyid dynasty. After the Sayyid dynasty, Delhi was ruled by the Lodi dynasty, and Ibrahim Lodi was the last king, or the Ibrahim Lodi was the important ruler in this dynasty. As you know, Qutbuddin Aibak, Iltutmish and Balban were the major rulers of slave dynasty. Don't forget their names, okay? The power of Delhi sultans expanded to other parts of Indian subcontinent too. As I said about Iltutmish, he was a powerful ruler who conquered Multan, Lahore, Bengal, etc. And he introduced a uniform monetary system in the regions under his control. Tanka and Jital were the newly introduced coins. Tanka and Jital were the newly introduced coins. Iltutmish introduced a uniform monetary system. Okay. And Tanka and Jital were the newly introduced coins. Okay, dear students, this is about today's topic. Let us wind up the class. Today we studied that Delhi became a seat of power under the leadership of Tomar kings. In that time, Delhi was known as Dillika. After the Tomar kings, Delhi was ruled by the Chauhan dynasty. And Chauhan was the first. Prithviraj Chauhan was the last king of Chauhan dynasty. After the Prithviraj Chauhan, Muhammad of Ghor defeated and established his dominance over Delhi. After the Muhammad of Ghor, Qutbuddin Aibak established his dominance in Delhi, and this dynasty was known as Mamluk dynasty or slave dynasty. After Mamluk dynasty, four major dynasties ruled Delhi. That is Mamluk dynasty, Khalji dynasty, Tughlaq dynasty, Sayyid dynasty and Lodi dynasty. Then we studied that Iltutmish conquered Multan, Lahore, Bengal, etc. And he introduced a uniform monetary system. That is Tanka and Jital. Tanka and Jital were the newly introduced coins. And this is the picture of Sultana Razia. Sultana Razia was the only woman ruler of the Delhi Sultanate. She was the daughter of Iltutmish. She lost her power owing to the protest from some nobles. Okay, dear.
Hi students, welcome to another session of the maths class. Last class we discussed about angles. This class also we are going to learn something more about the angles. Okay, let's see.
Students, seeing the answers you submitted to me, I could understand that some of you had some doubts between an acute angle and obtuse angle. In the last video I told you that an acute angle is narrower than an obtuse angle. An obtuse angle is wide open and an acute angle is smaller in size. Now you can see I have drawn 35 degree angle in two ways. Okay, the one is facing this side, the other one is facing the other side. Both these angles are 35 degree. Look here, you can just measure and show you. This is 35 degree. This one is also 35 degree. Okay, this has, the measure of the angle has nothing to do with the length of the sides. This side may be longer in this case and in shorter in this case. So the angle has nothing to do with the length of the arm. And this, these two are acute angles and both are 35 degree. One is facing the other side and the other one is facing the other side. So, but there is no difference between these two angles. Both are 35 degree and both are correct. Okay. Now let me explain how to draw an acute angle. So for drawing an acute angle facing that side, we'll just draw a line first. Okay, line of any length. And I'm going to make this side the vertex. The right hand side is going to be made vertex. So I keep protractor here such that the vertex comes here. Okay. Some of your protractors I told already that it will be having a point instead of this hole. This protractor is provided with a hole. Some of the protractor will not be having a hole, but it will be having a point here. Okay. So our vertex is here, this side, and our arm extending that side. I'm going to draw a line of 40 degree, which is slightly more than 30 degree. So if this is a vertex, our angle is moving this way, right? So 10 degree, 20 degree, 30 degree, and 40 degree. So this point is 40 degree. I have marked 40 degree. Now I'll remove the protractor. Taking the scale, I join these two points, that is the vertex to the point marked. You saw, no? This is a vertex. To this I join the point which I marked, and the measure of this angle is 40 degree. I can give any name to this angle, D, E, F, or you want to give some other names. It will be good that if I give an arrowhead at the end, even if I don't give an arrowhead, it's okay. But you can understand that I have drawn an angle of 40 degree. This is not the only way to draw 40 degree. I can draw 40 degree in the other way. That is, this has this facing this side. This vertex is on the right hand side and the opening is on the left hand side. Or I can draw with the vertex on the left hand side and the opening on the right hand side. For drawing that, I draw a line segment. Put the set square this side, not this side. I'm going to give the protractor this side. And I'm going to mark the vertex. I mark the vertex. Now look here. This is 10 degree, 20 degree, 30 degree, 40 degree. See, on the top of this, you can see there is 170, 160. You don't have to bother about that. When the vertex is this, you'll just look for this side. 0, 10, 20, 30, 40. You marked 40 degree and remove the protractor. Now take the scale and join. This point is called the vertex, okay? Now I join the vertex to the point marked, where it has been marked 40 degree. I join this. Okay, so this angle measures 40 degree. I can give any name to this. So I'm going to give it name PQR. This Q is the vertex. The name of this angle is angle PQR. Okay, so measure of this angle is 40 degree. Measure of these angles are 35 degree. These two angles are acute angles. Okay, I have drawn here four angles, two of the same measure. This is 35 degree, this is also 35 degree. This one is 40 degree and the next one is also 40 degree. Whether it is facing the other side or this side, no matter. Okay, next, drawing an obtuse angle also the method is same. First I have to draw the baseline. So I draw the baseline. I make this side the vertex. So I keep the protractor here so that the baseline and the baseline of the protractor lay on the same line. I mark the vertex here. Okay, now you can see the vertex. No, this vertex is clear. Now I want to draw 120 degrees. So beginning from here, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100, 110, 120. So this is 120. But up above you got a 60 there. Just straight to 120, you mark this point. Okay. You remove the protractor. Join this point to the vertex. Okay, join this point to the vertex. So now this angle measures 120 degree. I can give any name to this. I'm giving it A, B, C. So this angle is angle ABC. Angle A, this is the symbol of angle. Angle ABC is equal to 120 degree. Okay. Now here the vertex was on the left hand side. Now I'm going to draw the same figure with the vertex on the right hand side. So for that I draw the baseline first. I keep the protractor over it in such a way that the baseline and the baseline of the protractor lay on the same thing. That is, it lays one on the other. So now I can see the vertex. So here when I make this one vertex, I have to take this measures as 0, right? Look here. So this is my 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100, 110 and 120. So this 120 I'll be taking into account. So I measure, I mark this 120 here. So now I have to join it, no? I remove the protractor. I join the vertex to the point marked. Okay, so this is 120 degree. I can give any name to this. This can be named C, D, E or any other name, any other alphabets I can use. I am using here A, D, B. So this is, the name of this angle is EDC. Angle EDC is equal to 120 degree. Or I can call it angle CDE also. Whatever be, the D should come in the middle because D is the vertex. So now I have constructed angle of 120 degree. So both these are same. Okay, both are the same. Both are correct. Both angles measure 121 is having the vertex on the right hand side. And one is having the vertex on the left hand side. That's the only difference between these two figures. Okay, so let me show one more obtuse angle. Let me draw an angle of 95 degree. For that I draw the baseline. I keep the protractor on this. I keep my protractor. Now I want to draw 95 degree. So this is my vertex. I have 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, it goes like this, and this is 90 degree for me, and now this is 95 degree. 95 also is obtuse angle, so I remove the protractor. Using the scale, I join the vertex to this point. Okay, so this angle is 95 degree. I can give any name to this. X, Y, Z. Or if I draw in the other way also, it is the same thing. If I draw 95 in the other way also, that is making the vertex onto the left hand side also same. Now let's see how to draw 90 degree using the protractor. Last year we have learned how to draw 90 degree using the set square. Using the set square, the square edge of the set square is 90 degree. For drawing 90 degree, we have to draw the baseline first. Put the protractor on this baseline or the bottom line. This becomes the vertex. Okay, from straight from the vertex I take 90 degree. Okay, now to the vertex I can join this. So this is 90 degree. I can mark it as L, M, N. If I want to give, I can give an arrowhead. If an arrowhead is not given also, it's okay. But I'm giving an arrowhead. L, M, N or N, M, L. Angle N, M, L is equal to 90 degree. So this is one way of drawing 90 degree. I can draw 90 degree the other way around also. For that, I have to draw the baseline. Now I take the vertex on this side. So with vertex here, I can mark 90 degree here. I remove the protractor and I join the vertex. Join the vertex to the point marked. So this is 90 degree. So this one is GHI. Angle GHI is 90 degree. Now I have shown you how to draw angles of different measures using protractor, isn't it? Using protractor is more easier than using set square, I think so, isn't it? So because for drawing 90 degree, for drawing 95 degree and all, it is possible. Last year using set square you could draw only some certain measures like 45 degree, 30 degree, but here you can draw angles of any measure. So that is the convenience of, that is the convenience of a protractor, isn't it? So if I ask you to draw a square, you can draw, no? Isn't it?
Dear friends, in class 8, we are starting our first chapter named When a Letter Reaches the Computer. In this chapter, we are studying about word processor. Word processor is an application software that helps to create notices, letters, documents, etc. LibreOffice Writer is the word processing software in Ubuntu. Microsoft Word is the word processing software in Windows. AbbeyWord, CareWord, so many word processing softwares are there. Let us see how to open LibreOffice Writer in Ubuntu. See, you can see the window, Ubuntu desktop. Here click on application, then click on office, then LibreOffice Writer. LibreOffice Writer window has opened. In this we can type data, text or anything. Many ways we can enter text in the computer. It is a keyboard which is familiar to us that we use for this. The manner in which the letters of the alphabet are arranged in a keyboard is called keyboard layout. The information we given into the computer through keyboard are characters. These characters are called text. So we are entering text in the computer through keyboard. You can see when you examine a keyboard, you can see different letters, numbers, everything there. The first row of the keyboard is starting with QWERTY. So it is called QWERTY board. So in normal keyboard is called a QWERTY board. Another way of entering text in the computer is text from books. We can scan the books using scanner and we can enter that text in the computer. Software that converts handwritten words on the screen of our mobile phone into text is very common these days. Then text from speech, identifying the words of our speech, converting them to text and feeding them into a computer is another method. Convert the audio data that has been input into the computer into a text with the help of software. Then let us see text editing. We can edit the text in many ways. If we find mistakes after typing the matter, place the cursor on the incorrect word. You can use backspace key to delete the letter on the left of the cursor. To delete the letter on the right of the cursor, we can use delete key. Then type the correct letter. A dictionary is included in the word processor software. Each word that we type in is verified with this dictionary. When a word which has not been included in the dictionary is typed, it will be underlined automatically. Red underline will appear here. To correct this, right-click the mouse on the underlined word. Then a menu will appear. From that menu, you can select the correct word. In this way, we can edit the text if it is mistaken. Then let us see how to copy-paste the text. We can copy-paste or cut-paste the text in computer. When you copy-paste, we get the copy, duplicate copy of the selected text, and we can paste it in the new location. The original data will be remained in the original position. But in cut-paste, the selected text will paste it in the new location, but the original data disappears from the original location. So, today we studied what is word processor, different word processors, keyboard, QWERTY board, then editing the text, different ways of entering text in the computer, copy paste and cut paste. Okay. In this LibreOffice Writer, we know that we can type any language. Here in this screen, I am showing you the keyboard keys to type Malayalam letters. Study these keys for typing Malayalam letters and words. In our next video, I will show you how to type all these things. Okay.